Hello everyone, and you join me on the 356th anniversary of the Great Fire of London, which began on Thursday the 2nd of September 1666 and finally finished on Monday the 6th of September 1666, burning away in that 4-day period massive swathes of the old London that we're looking at now. This is the old London, pre-fire London, with London Bridge and the River Thames busy on all the old buildings. As I've said many times before in some of my videos, people in the old days would be able to tell their way around by church spires, churches being the tallest buildings in the land. As I say, the fire began in the early hours of the morning, or very late, on the 2nd of September 1666 in the King's Baker's House, Thomas Farriner, who was baker to the King. He probably hadn't raked his fire out, probably, and that may be what caused the fire. It's very highly likely what caused the fire anyway. But, a big but, this is how Thomas Farriner got away with it. A simple-minded Frenchman, who was obviously had mental problems, called Robert Hubert, or Robert Hubert. He was one of those people that claim to have done things that they've not done. And he claimed to have started the Great Fire of London by throwing a fireball, a small round ball like a grenade, through the window of Thomas Farriner's baker's shop. Only one problem with that, and modern forensics have been able to hone in on it. Thomas Farriner's baker's shop had wooden shuttered windows that would have and should have been shut up at that time of night. So you make your own conclusions and conjectures from that one. But Robert Hubert was hanged for his confession, and they did hang an innocent, simple-minded man for that one, but they wanted a victim, and Thomas Farriner didn't want that victim to be himself or any member of his family. The claim is that only a few people died in the Great Fire of London, the first being the maid of Thomas Farriner, who was too scared to jump from an upper window into the street, and she was the first victim that the fire claimed. It's claimed by modern day fire people and forensics and such like that a great deal more would have died, but the flames were so hot that it literally would have cremated people. And in those days they didn't understand forensics and treading carefully in burned buildings. The moment you disturbed one of these burned corpses, they would have just crumbled to ashes. So the conjecture is that many, many more would have died, because don't forget, London was packed with poor people and such like. So there we are. We're now going to venture into the old pre-fire of London city and see what our main protagonist or helper in this video, which is Samuel Pepys, whose diaries we're going to rely on for a great deal of our information, the city that he and his generation and those before it would have known and loved. So here we go into the next part of our video, which is a reconstruction tour of pre-Great Fire London. Hope you all enjoy. And here begins our little tour into the past. Pre-Great Fire London. A totally different world. This is a recreation made from accurate descriptions, paintings, portraits and accounts of the time, and maps. And you see the plague-ridden London. The plague had just preceded the fire the year before, so they'd really been through it, the poor Londoners. The Great Plague of 1665, followed shortly after by the Great Fire of 1666. And here you see what I'm always saying about in the old days, that churches being the tallest buildings around, that many people would tell their way around by church spires. These old narrow streets are what allowed the fire to spread so easily. That and the lath and timber frame houses, and the fact that the September that they'd had had been one of the hottest on record. London was tinderbox dry. similar to what we've just been through. Another heat wave. Here we see one of the old gates to the tower, to London Bridge. London Bridge had drawbridges and portcullises on it, and often the heads of traitors stuck up on spikes. Here we're seeing one of the many market streets and stalls. We've got chicken and chip shops nowadays. In those days you'd have pie shops, pie stalls, and the spit men, where you'd go and buy a nice slice of meat, beef or lamb, roasted on a spit. The Dutch commended us on the way we roasted meat. They said that the English roast their meat in perfection. Here we're seeing the old church of St. Clement Danes, pardon me. Blacksmith. Here we're seeing the dockyards. These burned very well because they were filled with brandy, rum and tar. Good evening, ladies and gents, and you join me on Pudding Lane. And it's near this site stood the shop belonging to Thomas Farriner, the King's Baker, in which the Great Fire of September 1666 began, presented by the Worshipful Company of Bakers to mark the 500th anniversary of their charter granted by King Henry VII in 1486. Zoom you back out. I'll show you where we are. Pudding Lane. And we're looking up at the monument to the Great Fire of London. I've done that one before. And on top there is a flame. And on top of the flame is a phoenix rising from the ashes, and that represents London rising from the flames. And over there is the Church of St. Magnus the Martyr, and where Old London Bridge originally started there. It's a little bit further along than where it is now. So as I say, this is the monument. This is Pudding Lane, and this is where the fire began, and that's where our journey is going to take us now, ladies and gentlemen. So here we go into the Great Fire of London.
On Saturday the 1st of September 1666, the King's Baker, Thomas Farriner, was preparing for the Sabbath. His bakery lay in Pudding Lane, a narrow alley famed for its cellars of sweetmeats, pastries, and of course, puddings.
Pudding Lane was a fast food area, really. There were probably cookhouses, as well as bakers and other food purveyors. And very busy at all times of day, particularly at midday when people wanted something to eat. There'd be cook shops, which were like open kitchens where you could buy a pie or a piece of roast pork very, very cheaply, and wander off down the street eating it. And people would be roasting on spits. I mean, you're not talking about one little spit with the joint on it. You're talking about four or five spits with two or three little boys turning them, each spit with about six joints on it. So you might have, 15 joints in front of a fire. So what you have is an enormous fire, and sometimes going up canopies that were made of wattle and daub. Sometimes the actual chimneys were not made of brick at all. They were hood fireplaces made of wood covered with mud, and sometimes they went up in flames. It's a dangerous place, Pudding Lane.
On the night of September the 1st, Thomas Farriner retired to bed, as a contemporary fire account observed, leaving his Providence with his slippers. It was the last night of old London. The fire started between 1 and 2 in the morning. It was first noticed by a journeyman sleeping above the ovens, who awoke to find his bedroom filling with smoke. Once it took hold, any Londoner knew that the first thing to do would be to evacuate the building as quickly as possible. But by the time the alarm had been raised in the rest of the house, the Farriners found the stairs impassable. They fled up to the roof space. Here, their maid was too frightened to jump down onto the cobbles below and became the first victim of the fire.
Afternoon, ladies and gents, and you join me at St. Olave's Church in Hart Street, but we're standing in Seething Lane at the moment, which was the heartland of my favourite historical Londoner, Samuel Pepys, who came through this gate from the Navy Office and his home in Seething Lane to worship here. My best beloved churchyard, the churchyard of St. Chastity Grimm, Charles Dickens, the uncommercial traveller, and then it's got other people from the burial register. 1586, September the 14th, Mother Goose, old known as Old Mother Goose. 1665, the Great Plague, 365 names. 1703, June the 4th, Samuel Pepys, that's when he was buried. Buried in a vault under ye communion table. And above the churchyard, just there, you'll see skulls and bones, and that's in the days when they would have this on churches and graves and things like that to remind the living to live, basically, and to try and be nice while they're doing it. This churchyard is much higher than the door we're going to see now, and there's a very good reason for that. All those names, the 365 names, and a good few that probably weren't able to be recorded as well. This floor in Samuel Pepys's day, before the Great Plague, this floor of the churchyard met the door there. After the plague, so many had been buried in this churchyard that it raised the floor level by about a foot and a half, and then in those days they didn't bury very deep and it was not pleasant, so they had to put more earth on top for obvious reasons. Anyway, over here, entrance to the South Gallery and the Navy Office pew, often mentioned in the diary of Samuel Pepys. This tablet erected in 1891. Basically here, there was a gallery. This church was bombed in the war, so above here was a gallery that belonged to the Navy Office, and that's where the men, workers and their families of the Navy Office would sit when they went to church services. Unfortunately, the church is closed today, but just on the inside of this wall, literally where this stone is on the inside of this wall, is Samuel Pepys's memorial. I did cover this church and the memorial previously before, but we're here for the Great Fire today. So we're going to be hearing Samuel Pepys's own words taken from his diary, his words about the fire. Here we go.
September the 2nd, 66. Some of our maids, sitting up late, called us about 3 a.m. to tell of a great fire they saw in the city. So I rose and slipped on my nightgown and went to the window and thought it to be on the backside of Mark Lane. But being unused to such fires, I thought it far enough off and so went to bed again. About 7, rose again to dress myself, and by my maid Jane comes to tell me that 300 houses have been burned and that it is now burning down all Fish Street by London Bridge. So I to the tower, and there got up upon one of the high places, and there I did see the houses at that end of the bridge, all on fire. So down with my heart full of trouble to the lieutenant of the tower, who tells me that it begun this morning in the King's Baker's House in Pudding Lane, and that it have burned St. Magnus's Church and most part of Fish Street already. I to Whitehall, and there up to the King's Closet, where people came about me, and I did give them an account, dismayed them all, and word was carried in to the King. So I was called for, and did tell the King and the Duke of York what I saw, and that unless His Majesty did command houses to be pulled down, nothing could stop the fire. They seemed much troubled, and the King commanded me to go to my Lord Mayor from him, and command him to spare no houses, but to pull down before the fire everywhere. Thus I returned to do the King's bidding with a sad heart. Thence we to a little alehouse on the bank side, and there stayed till it was dark almost, and saw the fire grow. And as it grew darker, appeared more and more, and in corners and upon steeples, and between churches and houses, as far as we could see, up the hill of the city, in a most horrid, malicious, bloody flame. September the 7th, up by 5 o'clock and by water to Paul's Wharf. Walked hence and saw all the town burned and a miserable sight of Paul's church, with all the roofs fallen and the body of the choir fallen into St. Faith's. Paul's school also, Ludgate and Fleet Street, and a good part of the temple the like. So to Mr. Creed's lodging, and there find him laid down upon a bed, the house all unfurnished because of the fire. There I did borrow a shirt of him and washed. People are speaking their thoughts variously about the fire and to the rebuilding of the city. February the 1st, 1667, up and by water from the tower to Whitehall, the first time that I have gone thence by water for several months, meeting with Mr. Povey. He carried me to Mr. Streeter's, the famous history painter, whom I have often heard of, and there found him and Dr. Wren. By and by comes Sir Robert Viner to ask Dr. Wren about measuring out the streets according to Dr. Wren's proposals for building of the city. March the 20th. Today I spoke with Mr. May, who tells me that the design of the rebuilding the city do go on apace. And by his description, it will be mighty handsome and to the satisfaction of the people. But I pray God it come not out too late.
And there you are, ladies and gents. That was the words of Samuel Pepys from his own diary. I'm going to pause this now, and you're going to join me at another part of Samuel Pepys' world. Another one of London's Corporation of London blue plaques. Basically, this marks the site of the Navy office where Samuel Pepys worked, and we're on Stephen Lane. That's where Samuel Pepys lived, worked, and where the Navy office was located on this very spot. Pause it again, and you'll join me again for something else in a minute. There we are, the statue of Samuel Pepys, and we're in the Samuel Pepys Memorial Garden, so to speak. Samuel Pepys, 1633 to 1703. And on the floor here are two of the most, there's lots of things depicted on the floor, but two of the most momentous events of Samuel Pepys' life: the plague, which had followed just the year before the fire. That was a plague doctor that we just saw, by the way.
And then the Great Fire of London itself. People were terrified coming up to the year 1666 because, being a bad number, 666, they had an inkling that something bad was going to happen, and London was tinderbox dry because they'd had such a hot summer. And Thomas Farriner's bakery, as you've already seen, went up, and the results of it was old London, a vast swathe of it, was wiped away. And that's what we're going to go and see now, recreation, and hope you all find it interesting. Join me again for the next part of the video.
Now the lead melts and runs down as if it had been snow before the sun, and great flakes of stone scale and peel off strangely from the sides of the walls.
An old lady taking shelter became the next victim of the fire.
Near the walls of St. Paul's, a human body presented itself to me, parched, as it were, with flames, whole as to the skin, meagre as to flesh, yellow as to colour. Her clothes were burnt, and every limb reduced to a coal.
The king now rode through the fire. He carried 100 gold pounds in a pouch swung from his shoulder and scattered coins among the workmen in encouragement.
The king's role in the fire and the rebuilding afterwards is almost the most interesting thing about the Great Fire of London. He got his hands dirty. Here was somebody who was the restored King of England, really presiding over one of the most magnificent, lavish, gay courts in Europe. There he was, going out and personally taking control of this hideous calamity.
The king now gave orders to move the exchequer to Surrey, while his brother James, the Duke of York, called in the navy to fetch gunpowder. Pulling down buildings was to no avail. Sailors from the fleet and workers from the dockyards at Woolwich and Deptford were now ordered to blow up buildings in order to create firebreaks. It was the only way to save what remained of London. At last, on Wednesday morning, after 4 days, there were signs of hope. The wind was stilled, and the firebreaks seemed to be working.
By Wednesday, the fire finally hit something that it couldn't burn, and that was the temple, the great brick and stone complex of lawyers' lodgings, which clustered around the temple church. The Duke of York came down. He was actually a bencher of the inner temple, and he came and presided over the last series of explosions, last bits of demolition, which finally stopped the fire dead in its tracks.
Although sporadic small fires still raged, by midday on Wednesday, September the 6th, 1666, the general conflagration had at last been put out. Samuel Pepys climbed to the top of Barking Steeple to survey the damage.
There saw the saddest sight of desolation that I ever saw. Everywhere great fires, oil cellars and brimstone, the fire being spread as far as I could see it.
He goes to see where his school was, and the school had been so important, his formation of the school, which had been Milson's school, the school from which he'd gone to see Charles I executed, the school which really formed Pepys's mind and made him into the very able man he was. So his whole childhood, his scenery, has gone. And for Pepys, the pattern of your life, the shape of the life of your life is very, very important. And I think for him to see all that just gone was powerful and depressing.
Despite the devastation, there were only 6 official deaths during the fire of London. Amongst them, the baker's maid, the old woman sheltering in St. Paul's, and an 80-year-old watchmaker who had been too frightened to leave his own home. But as those who survived looked out over their ruined city, it was as if there was only one question to ask. Who hath done this?